Thank you very much. It's really a great pleasure to be here with you this afternoon to share with you some ideas, and I'd like to thank the ARPA Institute and Dr. Mahmoud Panosyan for the invitation and congratulate on the 25th anniversary of this great organization. What I will present is not a social scientific paper, although it is informed by the social sciences, but an intellectual discernment on some of the prevalent issues in Armenian national life. I shall start with an introduction, then shall enumerate a few of the issues I believe are critical, and finally make some concrete suggestions. The often repeated rhetoric of one nation, one people, one church in parochial Armenian discourse, especially in the diaspora, has failed to resolve the critical problems facing the nation since Armenia's independence. The nation remains to be divided in many aspects between two halves and many parts, and with two church leaders. In recent years, however, a new discourse on global Armenians is increasingly becoming part of an effort of constructing a post-genocide Armenian identity in the diaspora and Armenia. These new identity shapers seem to advocate a transition from survival mentality to celebration of life and success. One definition was provided in a full-page letter published in the New York Times last year in October, according to which a global Armenian is someone who, despite having forcibly displaced and dispersed ancestry, lives across the world and has made or is making major contributions towards advancing their adoptive countries, unquote. Such global Armenians include scientists, doctors, engineers, and inventors making contributions to societies in their countries, politicians and diplomats serving in different countries, movie stars, sportsmen, bankers, and corporate executives, and of course, celebrities who have millions of followers on social networks. In short, a global Armenian is someone who is professionally successful, has an impact in their field, and has public visibility or recognition. One of the stated main goals of this prescriptive global Armenianism is to transform the post-Soviet Armenian Republic into a vibrant, modern, secure, peaceful, and progressive homeland for a global nation, unquote. This is indeed a vision that many in Armenia and the diaspora dream about. Of course, there are others who use the term global Armenian as a descriptive term or as synonym for dispersion. Yet even as global Armenians seem to be thriving in some hundred countries around the world, they don't seem to be thriving in the Republic of Armenia. With rare exceptions, global Armenians seem to exist everywhere except in Armenia. Instead, Armenia is visible through its oligarchs, that is a small number of people who have political, economic, social, and even cultural and religious power that survives through unquestioned loyalty, public obedience, or oppression. President Serzh Sargsyan himself affirmed at the opening of the 6th Parliament recently when he said, and I quote, "Indeed, today, the face of corruption in Armenia has changed. It is increasingly becoming more visible and untenable," unquote, he underlined. No, the vast majority of Armenians in Armenia and diaspora are not successful global Armenians, as defined by the evangelists of this new concept. 27 years after the earthquake in northern Armenia, some 3,000 Armenians still live in temporary shelters. More worrying, one-third of Armenia's population is poor, according to Armenian government state statistical services. The World Bank defines poverty as, I quote, "the the inability to ensure an acceptable minimum of certain living conditions, unquote. In fact, poverty increased by 2.3% between 2008 and 2015. An Armenian government report explains that, and I quote, the number of the poor in 2015 was around 900,000, of whom around 310,000 were very poor, and of the latter, around 60,000 were extremely poor. Meanwhile, in the diaspora, there are over 10,000 Syrian Armenian refugees in Lebanon alone, facing myriad of needs and uncertainties. Global Armenians, like the ocean crisscrossing Armenian merchants of the 16th and 18th centuries, might have preserved colonies or continued to keep communities spread across the world vibrant, even as they face the risk of assimilation spread over generations. However, preserving a nation is not the same as preserving a community. The homeland, Armenia, is the guarantor of the continuation of Armenians as a viable nation. Boğosluba, Karus Gülbenkian, Alex Malgian, and Kirk Krikorian, for example, are exceptions. But rich organizations and successful global Armenians are not collectively as rich to preserve a country. Successful individuals alone rarely create state institutions which are critical for societal prosperity. National institutions are created with the participation, engagement, and involvement of the larger society. Working together on specific projects or towards common goals is different from unity, unified, or united activities, often repeated terms in Armenian discourse, but virtually never fulfilled. A nation becomes prosperous when all segments of society, with their talents, capabilities, and all sorts of resources, are engaged in the process of building a preferred future. In the last century, we have been successful in building prosperous communities and preserving Armenian identity in the diaspora. In the last 25 years, we have been engaged in the process of state building. But what we have yet to complete is the process of nation building, a process that is not the mere endeavor of individuals or a certain group of people, but a long-term collective project. I suggest we could view nation building as the process of fulfilling or taking the efforts started in the diaspora in the last 100 years and since Armenia's independence to their logical conclusion. In short, nation building is the construction of an Armenian national identity through the power of the Armenian state. And this rather long introduction brings me to my main question. Could Armenians remain a global nation with a broken homeland? A homeland plagued with poverty, corruption, and depopulation. Even as we should celebrate and promote global Armenianism, a mark of regeneration and integration into global society, we need to be cautious about the temptation to brush aside the real problems facing the Armenian nation. Individually, Armenians have been very successful. They have become global citizens. But institutionally, our collective life bears the shackles of at least three issues, in my view. First, the past. We do a lot of retrospection, but very little prospection. Second, lack of national philosophy, or a set of common values around which we could gather collectively. And third, we lack transformative leadership. That is, we have many leaders, but we seem not to have leadership. And let me elaborate on these three issues. First, the past. I suggest that we need a major shift of perspective in our national discourse from the past to the future. The past, our glorious and not so glorious history, rather than the future, seem to be determining what we ought to do in the present. In this sense, the wise remarks of the late Catholicos Karekin, the first of all Armenians, are instructive. And I quote, he said, "The glorification of the past does not mean turning the past into a worship idol. If we continue to glorify the past to a point that we are filled and drunken by it, we would betray the past. Do not forget that the past is not past. It lives in us as a source of inspiration for new activities, new creations. We are a ring on that chain which is the march of our life, spread over the centuries and striving towards the future." Unquote. Seeing the present from the future does not mean looking into a crystal ball, but seeing the impact and consequences of our own actions and inactions today on the future. And it means as well as determining where we wish to go in the coming years and decades. For instance, according to the United Nations projections, in 2015, Armenia's population will go down to 2.7 million, and in 2100, down to about 1.8 million. While Russia and Georgia will also see decline in their population numbers, Turkey, Azerbaijan, and Iran will see natural growth. We know now, today, what will happen to Armenia's population in 30, 40, 50 years. 20 years ago, we knew what impact the oligarchic system would have on Armenia's population and the country's economic development. And we can be sure what we could expect in the next 5 to 10 years if the current system of governance in Armenia continues. It is in this perspective that we need to look at the present from the future. Secondly, we need to see Armenia and global Armenianism in the context of critical global developments. We live in a world where societal polarization, income inequality, and the inward orientation of countries are spilling over into real-world politics. Tectonic shifts in politics, economics, and social upheavals are reshaping international relations. These changes have far-reaching impact on how countries relate to each other and how risks are managed. Coupled with high debt and demographic changes, this has resulted in financial crisis and growing inequalities. Armenia, as well as Armenian philanthropists and philanthropic organizations, are not immune to the risks that are brought by these shifts in global developments. A number of global factors have critical impact, especially on small nations such as Armenia. Widespread corruption, short-termism, and inequality in the distribution of benefits of economic growth around the world have underlined the failure of capitalism as an economic model which has not delivered to the ordinary people. Ideologically speaking, neoliberalism, that is unregulated or slightly regulated capitalism, is under attack in many quarters around the world as a failed ideology. Neoliberal policies of the past decades have created inequalities in societies. These inequalities challenge the very foundations of democracy, as we have seen in Armenia and the rest of the world, where the wealthy and the powerful have greater influence on politicians, political representation, policy making, and public discourse than the vast majority of citizens. In terms of geopolitics, in Armenia's immediate neighborhood, the post-Ottoman secular Arab nationalism of the Middle East of the last century has crumbled due to upheavals and wars in the region. Meanwhile, the political horizon for the resolution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is bleak for the foreseeable future. The Middle East continues to witness mass movement of people within the region and without, especially to Europe. Against this political and economic background, technological advancements, or the so-called the fourth industrial revolution, are transforming societies, economies, and ways of doing business in ways never seen before. These have positive benefits for societies, but also unforeseen consequences. Even as globalization has blurred personal and societal identities, many societies are addressing such anxieties by reasserting their personal and collective identity. International relations are becoming less cooperative and more inward-looking. Emotions, rather than rationality, are informing decision-making and political positioning. We need to look at our present from the perspective of the future of technology. We know that in the short and medium term, for example, artificial intelligence, virtual reality, augmented reality, and such unprecedented technologies would become positive disruptions. What are the benefits and uses of such technological disruptions for Armenia and Armenians, for instance? In a post-hardware world, which is a topic discussed among specialists these days, the intelligence in the machines rather than the machines themselves would be the center of attention. These would certainly have uses and impact on education, cultural production, trade and industry, defense of borders, and so on. The global risks and economic, political, and technological trends that drive them are opportunities for responsive leadership. In the Armenian case, a leadership that would aim to uplift society towards long-term prosperity by engaging and collaborating across stakeholder groups, multiple areas of expertise and talent, and interconnected systems. For at least two decades now, we often speak about the lack of adequate leadership or lack of will in Armenia and the diaspora to improve the state of the nation. I believe leadership alone is not enough. What we critically lack is a clear and common understanding of our national values. Arjehamagard, as we say in Armenian. What are our most important national values? And this brings to my second part. Throughout history, I suggest three pillars have been significant and constant in Armenian national ethos, and that is church, school, and books, intellectual production. In modern terms, these would be spiritual moral values, education, and communications. These three pillars or institutions have defined, maintained, and developed Armenian identity, especially in the diaspora, for at least the last 300 years. In the globalized world of the 21st century and with Armenia's independence, these proven identity pillars have been going through a period of transition and need renewal. While today the church, or more precisely, the church leadership, is failing to provide the spiritual, moral, and ethical grounding for Armenian identity and national life, there is a need for a new philosophy that is based on millennia-rich Armenian wisdom, moral, ethical, social, and cultural values that have sustained our national life, especially in times of great crisis and transition. Today, the elephant in the room that the leadership neither in Armenia nor in the diaspora are willing to see or acknowledge is the absence of a national philosophy, a philosophy in the widest sense, particularly its moral and ethical dimensions. As the experience of the last 25 years show, political and economic development, social cohesion, basic social justice, etc., would remain problematic without the adoption, promotion, and exercise of sets of moral ethical values, values that are both universal and Armenian. In short, what are the value components of Armenian identity? Armenians like to compare themselves often with Israel and the Jews or with other European nations. So let us look at a few examples of values that are upheld by various societies. In Denmark, for instance, Danish values and philosophy are woven around the idea of interdependence in society. Their sense of safety and comfort comes from the surety that material and psychological benefits of living in a society are tangible and accessible. In the Danish way of thinking, having a secure life is more sensible than taking big risks. Sharing and community are complemented with the feeling of security and thus the idea of the welfare state. In Singapore, values such as integrity, resilience, and teamwork, respecting and valuing every individual and their contribution, are among the sets of values that provide guidance to individuals and organizations. As for the Jews, for example, in a 2012 Jewish Values Survey, when asked what informed their political beliefs and activity, 8 in 10 American Jews said pursuing justice, that's 84%, and caring for the widow and the orphan. Another 55% said seeing every person as made in the image and likeness of God, unquote. Interestingly, according to a recent Pew Research Center survey of religious beliefs and national belonging in Central and Eastern Europe, Armenians, this was conducted in Armenia, Armenians scored the highest in a few categories among 18 countries. Armenians tend to be more philosophical than their neighboring countries. 79% in Armenia say they often think about the meaning and purpose of life. 57% said they feel a deep connection with nature and earth. 83% said they believe in fate. And 72% said they believe in miracles. And these were the highest percentage among their peers or the neighboring countries. What are or should be the basic values that would provide a common denominator for Armenians? This is, of course, the million-dollar question and one of the most complex and complicated problems. I believe answers to such questions should be the result of a process of collective and public thinking, discernment, and deliberations. I don't have a ready answer, but I would start with two items, the other two pillars of the Armenian heritage that I noted earlier. Throughout our history, education, the school, has been one of the most significant institutions in our national life. Education, or love of wisdom, imastasimutyun, is part of our national fabric. From the 5th century Golden Age to medieval Armenian monastic universities like Datev and Akhbat, to the establishment of schools as priority for survival after the genocide and so on. Education, as we know from experience, is not just schools, but a wider project that includes instilling values, character building, and etc. In short, education is the process or vehicle by which the national philosophy is transmitted and made a living experience. Finally, the third pillar is communications. From the ancient manuscripts to tens of thousands of newspapers, magazines, periodicals throughout the last few centuries, communications has been the glue that has bound the Armenian nation together, intellectually, morally, and experientially. In the absence of statehood, transmission of knowledge and values through the print media has been part of our national fabric. Today, we have wider opportunities with new technologies to reach millions of Armenians rather than only pockets of Armenians or local communities as it was the case in the past. In brief, any serious transformative approach to our national life must include these proven pillars that would define the new Armenia in the 21st century. If we are to see progress in the coming years, a holistic approach to the development of Armenian national life is necessary. For instance, it has become very clear that you cannot leave politics out of the equation of Armenia-diaspora relations. While the economic and humanitarian aspects have been well-studied areas for national development, there has been virtually no discussion about our national philosophy, which would be driven by education and communications, and which will connect our present values to the past and would build a preferred future. And my final point, leadership and what needs to be done. Over the last 25 years, external and objective problems have been imposed on Armenia and Armenians. Restoring statehood in the post-Soviet era has been affected by many external factors, as we know. However, internally, one of the most critical problems for the prosperity of the country has been the lack of responsive and responsible leadership. Not lack of leaders, but leadership. Civil society, both in Armenia and the diaspora, is not involved in the decision and policy-making processes. For that matter, diaspora institutions, churches, parties, community organizations, rarely involve their wider membership or the wider community in their decision making. Generally, independent professionals, experts, academics, business people are ignored unless it is for their financial contributions or their limited input. The first step towards building consensus around national values or philosophy is to create a visionary and transcending leadership which would articulate and address the most critical national issues. Such a step would bring together the knowledge, experience, talents, and resources of a wide range of individuals, institutions, and seemingly disconnected but equally well-meaning community leaders and members of the public. The aim should be transcending personal or organizational agendas for the greater good of the homeland and Armenians around the world. I believe three categories or groups of people need to come together in order to overcome the failures of such attempts in the past. The three categories are what I call the thinkers, the doers, and the makers. The thinkers are intellectuals, academics, professionals, activists who are independent of loyalties to parochial agendas and have a track record of objective approach to national issues. The second group, the doers, as I call them, are elected or appointed executives of organizations that have impact and influence in the Armenian world. And the third category, the makers, as I call them, are the visionary individuals who have or control considerable financial and organizational resources, who value collective efforts for long-term benefits over gratifying short-term successes. What I'm proposing, of course, is not necessarily a novel idea, but a practical one. Of course, there are some pan-Armenian organizations that do a lot of good for Armenia and Armenians. However, virtually none has been able to articulate and engage Armenians around a national philosophy for the 21st century. There are indeed lessons that could be learned from the past successes and failures. If we are to remain a global nation, we need to fix our homeland by drawing strength and lessons from the past, but must look at the present from the perspective of the future. In this process, we need to pay attention to our axiology and cultural values to complement and strengthen our efforts towards economic prosperity and especially political leadership. The ultimate challenge is how do we make collective ideas, values, and directions towards a preferred future come to life in our national life? And I leave you with that question. Thank you.